of proliferative diabetic retinopathy as our kind of our category. So the first one we were going to do was the DRS, which literally stood for Diabetic Retinopathy Study. So we called it DOG.
Okay, so the main question for this was just in general, is photocoagulation, so either argon or xenon arc, effective for treating diabetic retinopathy?
So they're basically like, does pew pew plus sugar eyes, what is that? How does that, how does that help? Okay, so we're looking at PRP.
It's been a long time. So initially they enrolled patients that had PDR or bilateral severe NPDR. And they had, it was quite a large study of 1,700 participants. And one eye got treated and the other eye did not. And their outcome they were looking for was severe vision loss at 5 years. So they followed them for quite some time.
So yeah, each patient had two diabetic eyes. One got pew-pew, one got no pew-pew. And then they looked at severe vision loss 5 years later.
And the results, so at 5 years, the PRP-treated eyes had at least a 50% reduction in rates of severe vision loss compared to the, their control eyes. And they found that those that fit the high-risk PDR category achieved the greatest benefit from the treatment, and that they had kind of advised at the end of the study that prompt treatment in that group was advised. And the complications that they had was that there was a decrease in visual acuity by at least one or more lines in 11% and loss of visual field in at least 5%, but this was more common in the xenon arc-treated eyes.
So our results were that the diabetic eyes that did get PRP had, this is the symbol for vision, severe vision loss, had 50% less vision loss, since that was their outcome, than the eyes that did get, did not get PRP 5 years later. So our conclusions are that treating diabetic eyes with PRP is a good treatment option, and especially for high-risk PDR. High risk. Anyway. So that was the conclusion or the main kind of simplified breakdown of the DRS. We also had Protocol S.
When was DRS study done?
Oh, shoot, that's right.
1981 or
88? Yeah, a long time ago.
Older some than some of us, right?
Yes, except for Tyler.
He's still relevant.
He's an old soul.
Okay, and then we also had Protocol S, since Brandon and Marshall are on vacation and on interviews, but we took some slides from last year, which was made it easy. So the question, the main question was basically, again, a pretty landmark study is anti-VEGF, specifically they tested with Lucentis, an effective alternative to treatment of PRP for PDR.
So this study, again, like Catherine said, it was PRP versus Lucentis, and their primary outcome was vision loss, but they also looked at visual field changes, the development of DME, and the rates of vitrectomy. And they followed these patients for 2 years, and I just wanted to let everyone know, like, if you did have center-involving DME at baseline when you were enrolled, you were still allowed to be participate in this study, and they were treated with Protocol I, so that was not something that they kind of ruled out patients for.
Yeah.
This slide is from last year. But basically the high points are that they had 394 eyes with active PDR and no prior PRP. And they were randomized either into 6 monthly injections of Lucentis, or they got immediate PRP with like from 1 to 3 sessions, whatever it took to fill it in. And then the boxes on the far right just show that those with baseline DME got more injections of Lucentis. So if you didn't have baseline DME, you got less. And that those that got PRP overall, I think it was like, received a median of 9 injections. Whereas those that didn't have any DME didn't get any.
So basically there are 2 groups, one with pew-pew, one with owie. And again, they measured severe vision loss, but this time 2 years later.
And so what they found was that Lucentis was not inferior to PRP in the treatment of PDR. They also found some benefits of doing anti-VEGF, like they were less likely to lose visual field, they were less likely to develop DME, and they didn't need vitrectomy as often. And that those eyes that had DME at baseline that were treated with anti-VEGF had a better improvement in vision than those that were just treated with PRP.
Yeah, and that's including for treated with PRP for those patients that had baseline DME in the beginning of the study. All right, so to summarize, what the study said is that diabetic eyes treated with laser are not inferior to the diabetic eyes treated with anti-VEGF. And in fact, like we said, that there may be benefits to treating with anti-VEGF, including no loss of visual fields, and then also maybe less DME, and then also less complications from vitrectomy. So, like I said, and then, oh wait.
2 years outcome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 2 years outcome.
They're still working on the 5 years.
Yeah, because this one came out in 2018.
Yeah, so pretty recent.
20 years apart, yeah.
Yeah, cool. All right.
Then we have management of diabetic macular edema coming up next.
DME?
Yeah, Abigail Anthony.
Oh,
just to kind of, in clinical practice, right, at Moren, and I think so most at most academic center, we still use laser a lot to treat patients with high risk PDR, and very often we do combine. You know, if they present with high risk PDR that already have like bleeding, active NVI, like just, you know, an angry looking eye, then we often start with anti-VEGF and then reschedule for laser, or we do both at the same day. We do laser first, you know, half session, and then we do the injection at the same day if, you know, if they have like, you know, very angry looking high-risk PDR at the time of presentation. Okay, now diabetic macular edema treatment.
Yeah, so Abigail isn't here today, so I'll be presenting on her behalf. I have the ETDRS, and I actually didn't know there were multiple reports, but the one that was in the BCSC covered there is report 9, and this is for DME. So the questions here is, how is photocoagulation effective for treating DME for diabetic retinopathy? And they also want to take a look at aspirin, how that would affect progression, if it would prevent it. So the methods are pretty similar to the previous presentation. They looked at patients with mild NPDR all the way to early PDR with visual acuity better than 20/200. And then they had in total about 3,700 patients, one eye to photocoagulation versus one eye not, but they also randomly assigned patients to 650 milligrams of aspirin versus a placebo. And the outcome was for at least 4 months vision, or some of these were outcome measures they looked at. Visual acuity worsened 5/200 for at least 4 months, a visual acuity worsening by two times, like 20/40 to 20/80, and then looking at how the DR progressed.
Wait, real quick.
Yeah.
What is 5/200 vision? Is that?
Yes.
2800? Like what?
I don't think so. So it's
it's just the same math.
So it's 2800.
As long as it wasn't worse than 2800, right? Is what they're saying.
No,
I don't know how.
The outcome is 2800.
Or worse, okay.
Is that the same thing they
said? I didn't know that it transferred. I just, from what I understand, it's the 2200, but you have to be 5 feet from the thing.
Oh.
That's the
notation.
Wouldn't it be
20,
50?
It's
2050.
That's at least what I got from the BCSC,
okay.
Like visual acuity, like how you measure it.
Okay.
Or,
yeah, really,
so really bad.
Like
bad.
So 5 feet from the 2020 chart.
Okay.
So macular edema results. So just jumping to the results they have, the photocoagulation, overall pretty good. It decreased risk of moderate vision loss, actually also increased chance of gaining vision, and reduce retinal thickening, so both functional and also in the retina, better or decrease edema. For scatter photocoagulation, so I think scatter would be PRP, and this, there was a reduction in severe vision loss, but just a small risk reduction. It's not for mild to moderate diabetic retinopathy, so more for a severe NPDR and PDR. And then it's more effective for type 2 diabetes, but not for type 1. And then for the aspirin results, it didn't really affect diabetic retinopathy, but it didn't really make it worse in terms of vit heme. But overall, it was good for just cardiovascular health. So conclusions, this was from the report 9 that I was able to get from just reading it online. And overall, it said that photocoagulation was pretty good at increasing visual acuity, lowering DME, and did not have a lot of visual field losses. And this is all for focal. Focal was better than scatter and for DME, and also you should consider it if there was threat or presence of center involving DME. And overall, aspirin was not too helpful, but just good for cardiovascular risk. That's it.
When they talk about focal laser, they what it meant is that, you know, they target at a specific macro aneurysm that, you know, you can visualize on FA. Okay, so that ETDRS was probably in 1990s or
91.
Yeah. And then now we're going to go on to the DCR protocol I and V with Mike and Cole.
I and V, right?
Not yet. We're still doing a diabetic myeloedema with, do you want to connect it though ahead of time? That's fine.
No, I thought you were already. I'm sorry.
Ours is really flashy. Okay, more DME stuff. So Tony talked about focal laser for DME. This is comparing anti-VEGF therapy to focal laser for DME. And I think they just got the 5-year results in like 2018 for this one. They had a ton of groups. Basically, you either got prompt or deferred laser, and deferred laser was like 6 months later, or you got Lucentis with that laser, either prompt or deferred, or you got triamcin alone, intravitreal. And they found superior visual outcomes, meaning you gained more ETDRS letters if you had Lucentis compared to the focal, and that was sustained over 5 years. And if you had adjunctive laser treatment, meaning in addition to Lucentis, that was didn't give you additional benefit, but it did reduce the number of injections that you got. So if you did both, it didn't change the visual outcome, but it reduced injections. And then if you deferred laser, like in group three, that only showed benefit in folks with worse acuity at baseline. So you're not like hitting them with everything at once. In the steroid group, they did have similar visual outcomes, but that was only in pseudophakic patients, and they had higher risks of IOP spikes, need for glaucoma surgery. So steroid was considered second line based on this. And so the anti-VEGF's better than focal for treatment of DME. You can reduce injection burden by doing adjunctive laser. And then another key point from this is that both anti-VEGF and steroid kind of made your retinopathy severity better in all levels of NPDR. And this was the first algorithm where they did kind of PRN-driven injections, meaning you got 6 monthly injections, and then you could start deferring once their acuity was stable and their OCT thickness was stable. So that was kind of a monumental thing for this one.
All right. Then V, this one was looking at 20/25 or better eyes with center involving DME. Is Lucentis better, laser, or just observation? So this is 702 patients, 2-year follow-up. Big thing on results was it didn't matter. So whether you did intravitreal injections, whether you did PRP, whether you did observation, only 16%, 70%, or 19% of people got worse than 20/25 or their baseline. And just as a side note, anyone who got worse did get additional treatment with Lucentis. And then one other thing just to note that's kind of interesting is that the percentage of eyes that were 20/20 or better was better with Eylea, but that was a statistical significant, not clinically significant, because it was like 2 letters better. So Just kind of like clinical pearls for us, if you have center-involving DME, even if it looks pretty bad, and they're 20/25 or better, you can be observed. And then you can inject if the vision gets worse. And then kind of our paradigm, unlike AMD, where you treat fluid, in DME, you should let it be guided by vision. So.
Now, center-involving DME, how is that defined?
In this one, I think they said...
Center 1 millimeter, I believe.
I think in mine, it was 500 microns, bromnophobia.
So, yeah, to the class, the BCSC definition of center-involved DME is the central subfield of the ETDRS chart over the macula, so the very center is 1 millimeter. So that's
500 on each side.
Yeah, so that is small. That's smaller than the side of the optic nerve. You know, when you have the OCT scan, if you, is the optic nerve on average is about 1.5 to 1.75 millimeter in diameter. So really, like, so sometimes when you guys are like, is that center involved? A lot of time it's not really, right? It's not at the, under the fovea. Yeah, it doesn't fit the definition.
Yeah, Ellie and I were looking at the page in BCSC where it shows like what the center involving is, and it shows the OCT, and there's literally like fluid that I would think is like right next to the fovea, but then when you look at the map, it's like not in that circle.
Right.
So I was like, oh, we would have treated that.
Right.
Yeah, but
so
it's interesting to see how close it is.
These are research things.
Yeah.
And just to clarify, I mean, even if it if it's outside, then it's even more reason not to treat it.
Right. Yeah.
Cool.
Okay, now we're going to move on to vein occlusion, and macular edema secondary to vein occlusion with Lydia.
I find your colors very
talk about VEVOS and CVOS last year, right? So this is something that we touched on last year. This is a very, very, very old study.
Tyler, were you here when?
Yeah, I was. I was 20 at the time.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to talk about vein occlusions, and I put this picture of the canyon because. That whenever the canyon gets occluded, that's the view. And surprisingly, it's not only occluded during ski season, but also during a word that I just learned, leaf peeping season. What is that? Okay. So vein occlusions. I kind of did it a little bit different in that I looked through the BCSC and tried to give a few highlights before we move on to the studies. So for vein occlusions, it's important to know that they are associated with age and hypertension, and that glaucoma, both open and narrow angle, is a major risk factor. When we look at the fundus, we see intraretinal hemorrhages, dilated tortuous veins, and sometimes cotton wool spots. Macular edema is best detected with SDOCT, and ischemia is best detected with fluorescein angiography. Two important things for central retinal vein occlusions is that neovascularization occurs commonly in the anterior segment. And obtuciliary shunt vessels, so vessels going from the choroid to the retina, like the small vessels that we have surrounding the optic nerve, they are dilated and commonly found in central retinal vein occlusions. And overall, it's important to know that the best visual acuity outcomes are achieved by administering anti-VEGF immediately when retinal vein occlusions are diagnosed when they have macular edema. For BRVO, it's important to note that they are commonly found in the supratemporal quadrant, so 63% of the branch retinal vein occlusions are in that quadrant. Risk factors are age, hypertension, smoking, glaucoma, and hypercoagulable conditions. And BCSC notes that diabetes is not a major independent risk factor for branch retinal vein occlusions. And we'll talk about the treatment later a little bit when we talk about the different studies. But as I mentioned before, the pharmacologic management is always the mainstream first-line therapy. Macular laser surgery showed some benefit, and photocoagulation also shows regression of vessels and risk reduction of vitreous hemorrhage. and in central retinal vein occlusion that can range between mild and from mild to severe disease. Like mild is usually 20/100 visual acuity or better, and ischemic disease is when it's like large areas, at least 10 optic disc areas of non-perfusion. Mostly central retinal vein occlusions have either thrombosis of the retinal vein at or posterior to the lamina caprosa, and we have a thickened central retinal artery that can impinge the vein. And risk factors here, diabetes is included, so I think that's important to know, as well as hypertension, glaucoma, hyperlipidemia, hypercoagulable conditions. And we should monitor central retinal vein occlusions monthly in the first 6 months, as complications can include vitreous hemorrhage, neovascularization, and neovascular glaucoma. And again, the treatments, pharmacologic treatment is the mainstay. Laser surgery does not improve visual acuity, and photocoagulation does not decrease neovascularization. So important studies, the VVOS and the CVOS, those are the two that we focused on, and they are relatively old studies. So VVOS was published in 1984. It's the branch vein occlusion study, multi-centered randomized controlled trial, and the two things that it wanted to figure out is the efficacy of argon macular laser. So argon macular laser therapy in treating macular edema secondary to the vein occlusion, and then the argon scattered PRP to prevent neovascularization and hemorrhage. And it's important to note that these like gold standards that were defined in these trials were before intravitreal injections were available. So the first outcome when we look at the argon macular grid laser therapy is basically looking at like patients that were treated versus non-treated, and it showed that it was highly significant, that the argon grid laser was helpful, and that was established as the gold therapy at that time. And as I said, like 139 eyes follow up for 3 years, and there was a significant benefit of the argon laser therapy. And then the argon laser PRP, similar story, we had treated eyes and non-treated eyes, and there was a significant benefit of treatment, and was basically established as a gold standard to prevent neovascularization and vitreous hemorrhage. And then the CVOS was published in 1995, so a little later, and the purpose was to evaluate grid laser macular edema associated with central retinal vein occlusion, and there was no significant difference between treated and non-treated eyes, which is why laser is not recommended for central vein occlusion. And visual acuity, not OCT, was the main outcome measure for both of those trials. I think when we look at what BCSC says, those studies are like not even really mentioned much in BCSC because they're outdated. So I think the important things that came out of those studies are really the risk factors that I mentioned earlier that go along with BRVO and CRVO, and I just have them up here again. But when we go to the next group that is presenting, the pharmacologic treatment is the mainstay, and I think that's the important point.
We sometimes still do focal laser for branch retinal vein occlusion when there is like good like area of MA outside of the central macula.
When do you see clinics doing that? Is it like they come in, they get diagnosed, and it's like the FA is like pretty amenable to that, or do they always start with anti-VEGF?
They always start with anti-VEGF, and he usually is the fellow who like push for.
Like once it's refractory.
Yeah. Because it is, you know, it does take more effort and coordination to do focal laser than just to like, you know, an injection, right? But like you see that it's refractory, the multiple like allele, even try steroid and still refractory, then I think it's a good time to try focal laser. And I've seen that, you know, being effective for some patient. We just thought sometimes we forget about this option because we saw used just to like inject. Okay. And then one important thing to get from Lydia's presentation is that, you know, the frequent monitoring for the first 6 months, and you know, that's why sometimes when you guys present to me case at the VA, I always ask, when was the onset of the vein occlusion? So that we document it so that we be more diligent about follow up earlier on, and then after 6 months we can relax if they don't have macular edema that require monthly treatment. Well, and then the optocerebellar shunt vessel, oftentimes it could be tricky to try to distinguish between that, which is a positive findings, right, versus NVD, which is a negative findings, and sometimes it's hard to distinguish. So FA is your answer. Just get an FA and then document that, you know, the FA done on this day, confirm that it's, you know, optocerebellar shunt vessel and not NVD, so that we don't keep repeating the FA with each of the new resident. Okay. Let's move on to Bravo and Cruz. Sean and Tyler. Sean's not here.
Cheer when you're done and say Bravo.
Okay.
But you better kind of cruise with this. We're running out of time.
All right.
Gmail on open on this server by any chance?
I logged out. Well, did you log out of your Gmail?
So sorry.
What?
Did you log out of your Gmail?
Probably not.
So the Bravo study was looking at the safety and efficacy of ranibizumab in patients with macular edema secondary to a branch retinal vein occlusion. Busy slide, but a phase 3 multicenter randomized controlled trial looking at ranibizumab versus sham. Inclusion criteria include macular edema, central subfield thickness greater than 250 microns, and then best corrected visual acuity between 2040 and 2400. Participants were randomized to either 6 month injections of two doses of ranibizumab, 0.3 versus 0.5 versus sham, and they were eligible for rescue laser if they met certain criteria. Primary outcome was mean change from baseline best corrected visual acuity to 6 months, and then they had secondary outcomes as well. But 397 patients were randomized. The mean gain was at 6 months was 16.6 letters in the 0.3 milligrams, 18.3 in the 0.5 milligram, and 7.3 in the sham, showing that ranibizumab for branch retinal vein occlusion leading to macular edema was better than sham. And then their secondary outcomes also went in there, that more people gained 3 lines or 15 letters in their best corrected visual acuity with ranibizumab compared to sham. And then Cruz was its twin, only for central retinal vein occlusion. So everything was the same except for the results and the fact that they included central renal vein occlusion. So 392 patients were randomized. At month 6, 12.7 letters were gained on average for the 0.3 milligram group, 14.9 for the 0.5 milligram group, and 0.8 for the sham. And more patients gained 3 lines or better with the ranibizumab compared to sham. So the conclusions of the CRUSE, C for central, Bravo, B for branch, was that intravitreal injections of ranibizumab showed a statistically significant improvement in visual acuity compared to sham. Remaining questions that Bravo and CRUSE did not answer is, when patients present with a retinal vein occlusion and they ask us, what will my visual acuity be after treatment? We can't say based on these results. SCORE, I think, tried to answer that, but didn't, but showed that presenting visual acuity was the most important predictor of final visual acuity. And then, can an alternative dosing strategy of anti-VEGF, so they did one injection every month for 6 months. Can we do, for example, treat and extend with AMD, as we do with AMD, can that be applied to retinal vein occlusion? But Bravo and CRUSE did not answer those questions, but they came up at the end.
So the question of, you know, the different efficacy among the different regimen, you have PRN, you have monthly, and you have treat and extend, right? That question has been answered for AMD. And the answer is that the outcome in general are the same, whether you chose those three, one of those three regimen. I guess the only difference is, like, you know, would you rather multiple visit, or would you rather multiple injections and less visit? So that's why sometimes we offer patient, you know, the option. Practically, in clinical practice, we approach vein occlusion similarly to AMD, treat and extend, versus in diabetic macular edema, it's more of a PRN. Okay. So good job. You gotta take a little bit of break. I'm gonna go upstairs because I forgot the bells.
Bells.
How are
you?
Get ready. The bells.
Lisa, can you do me a favor?
Yeah.
Can you keep connected?
Yeah.
Let's say if it doesn't work, I will also email to you. My laptop, like last time, it was kind of flaky. Yeah, this is my email. Be right back.
A scar on his forehead where if he gets mad, it hits his, like, his forehead here.
It's like, I don't know, it's 6 weeks later or something.
He's not going to change.
sneak it in.
Powdered vitamin A.
It's funny because, like, I feel like all of our cold cereals are fortified. So, like, if a kid eats cold cereal, he's like,
you're
so,
good to go.
So hard.
Man.
That's crazy.
He needs fortified peanut butter.
I'm surprised they don't fortify.
I know, maybe they should.
It's like, you just put, you know, fluorine in the water.
In fact, positive visual symptoms that by another listener.
This TV static.
No. Visual snow is diagnosed in our clinics.
I don't know, Jock. I have this TV static and these floaters that I can see through that have been present for more than 3 months, and I see these trailing after images.
We have a resident who has that.
You have visual snow? We have a resident that has that.
I've had a lot of people ask me about what it's like to have visual snow.
Wait, Catherine. If you have visual snow, do you overgrade cell and flare?
No, Brad, not exactly. People have also sent a lot of up-and-coming research my way.
Catherine, I just found another paper on how patients with visual snow have hyperexcitable visual cortices. Are you hyperexcitable?
We have a resident who has that.
She did not, actually. I'm not going to press charges.
We should.
You looking?
I just opened up my email.
Okay. My laptop wasn't functioning?
I think it's because it's an older...
I know. That's why I was nervous about it, too.
Oh, yeah. That's okay.
Okay. So, you know what? There are an absence of 6 residents, so instead of having the group of 3, 4 team, let's just do 2 team. Okay. So, you guys can just... pick your team.
This way?
Let's have Mike and Catherine, so let's divide it by PGY level, right?
Probably
fine.
That's
probably
good. It's pretty good. Huh?
4, 3, 4, 3, 2, 2, 2.
Yeah.
That's
even.
Yeah. We'll take Mubarak when he comes back. He's clutch. He's clutch.
Dr. Jacoby got this bell.
Oh, those are nice.
So maybe I just give 2 bells to each team.
There's some batteries afterwards, and they can ring them if they've been waiting too long.
So these are the exact same question like last year. I didn't change it because Catherine told me not to change them. So if you pay attention last year, you should...
I don't remember them.
You should know all of them.
Did Nico do it?
Nico
did it,
yeah.
But he bought bike things from the dollar store and left the tag on it.
Like, don't leave the tag on.
The little ringers.
Yeah.
Bike bell.
So I didn't bring candy for you guys this year. Like, no candy to throw out.
Pride.
Huh? Yeah. Are there prizes, though?
Donuts. It was not really a prize, but I bought an additional thing that you got to try.
I feel like the prize is Hong Yam hooking us up with, like, $50 sushi and $25 all this stuff.
Oh, yeah. So these are, like...
I put in my orders.
Mango
like,
pudding
man.
Is an Asian treat.
$49.95.
Okay, I feel like we always learn all the sugar stuff.
Price and like,
yeah, it's gonna be a lot of fun. Mubarak, you're over here.
Come on, the winning team. Yeah.
Mubarak, you're on that team.
Should we make that up?
More treats, there you go. Okay.
Nice.
You get our team? Should we start?
Okay, that's
an
interesting one.
Wait,
why
do I have one?
Because we're on the same team, everyone gets 2.
What's well, Jeopardy-ish?
I don't know.
Should we just like get 1?
Yeah, let's come here.
Come here.
Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here.
Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here. Come here.
supposed to grab a buzzer.
Let's hear our official buzzer.
You have two?
Ignore the rule. I'm not gonna go through the rule.
Yeah, sure. Reach it.
Outside of the fovea, that's a telltale sign that there might be an MA here, leaking, right? So this is a good patient, with especially VA patient, poor follow-up. He basically hit three criteria for focal laser.
VA patient, and no, I'm just kidding.
Oh.
It's a criteria.
So CSME, you know, this is the this is in the, which study that we talk about today for CSME? ETDRS, right? This the definition of CSME was defined in ETDRS. No longer relevant in clinic. We no longer describe these three criteria. Why? Before OCT, how do ophthalmologists grade the CSME?
By looking clinically at the
looking.
With what lens?
Contact lens.
Oh, contact lens.
So we don't use that anymore, right? So you can't really make this judgment with a 90 or super view or 78 lens for that matter. It has to be with the contact lens for you to appreciate the depth, right? With focal laser, we start a much lower, it said here 100 milliwatt, but I probably would start at like, you know, even 50, 80, and then crank up. Instead of 200 micrometer, which is what we use in PRP, we use 100. And instead of 100 duration, we use 50 millisecond duration and can titrate it up. So start slow and crank up.
Hong up, I've never done focal. How well can you see the spots where you've treated? Can
so,
you see them well?
No, that's the thing. You start very low, and then the moment that you see the spot, you lower it again. So you shouldn't see your spot.
You should not, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Joe and I have looked at patients like a focal at the VA, and like over time on their OCT, their scars become like massive.
Yes.
They're just like so small to begin with, or faint, like on OCT, and then like years down the line, they're just like huge.
So once you start to see, like let's say if you were at 100 milliwatt, and you see a spot, you see a light spot, then go down to 80. Oh, go down, go back to the home button. Okay.
All right, let's do it.
Can we do a retinopathy for 100?
What stage? What stage of diabetic retinopathy does this patient have? Yes. Okay. So, tell us about what you see here on this PAT slide.
So you get the thickening of the posterior iris epithelium with cysts, and then there's probably some NVI there. I can't really tell.
Hey, I just somehow. Okay, you're back again. And then what about the black arrow? Iris neovascularization, lazy vascularization of iris pigment epithelium, that's what Cole talked about for the red arrow. Thickening up the basement membrane of pigmented ciliary epithelium. Okay, good job.
Sure, it's always on LCAPs. Like
yes.
Yes, it has been on LCAP twice.
Yeah, but it's also like, you know, like terrible quality. It looks like it's like that, but like really blurry.
Yeah.
Isolated. Like you have to figure out what you're doing.
Are we keeping track?
I'm keeping track. I have an Excel spreadsheet.
All right.
All right. Did we do arterial occlusion disease for 100?
Yeah.
What is the diagnosis?
Sir, daily double.
You and Spencer have been seesawing that.
Answer, daily double.
You and Spencer have been seesawing.
Answer, daily double. Answer, daily double.
Correct? Okay. So what made you say that when you first see the picture?
So I saw mid-peripheral hemorrhages, and then I also thought there was delayed filling there on the FA.
25.6 seconds. What is a normal arm to retina time in a healthy eye? Like 10 to 12-ish. But the technician had to be good, right? And the person who pushed had to try to push that within 10 seconds. Okay.
True story. One time at a certain clinic that I was at, we thought they were totally delayed, and the technician was like, oh, but there might have been a kink, and I like may have pushed a little bit late, and we were like, So like it totally, totally matters.
Yes.
And then we did it again, and they were normal.
Okay. All right. Yes, more dark blood hemorrhage. Splinting hem is what? Splinting hem is in the retinal nerve fiber layer. That's also known as, you know, flame shape, feather. That is more commonly in hypertensive retinopathy. Yeah. Okay.
Can we do other vascular disease for 100?
What sickle cell hemoglobinopathy is most commonly associated with proliferative sickle cell retinopathy?
No.
Dang it!
You guys can have it.
SC. So most common, 33%. Half of that is SL and very small SS, 3%. Bonus question here. What complication would you see more often after laser PRP for proliferative sickle cell retinopathy compared to diabetic proliferative retinopathy? Yeah, tears, detachment. That's why we don't go aggressive on this patient. Although, you know what, in my more than a year and a half, almost a year and a half here at Salt Lake City, I haven't seen a patient with sickle cell retinopathy.
One, they were from Florida.
Yeah?
There you go.
You're on vacation.
Oh, you're on vacation, they're not staying.
Can we do other vascular disease for 200?
Retinal arterial microaneurysm RAM. There must be a picture here.
There's RAM.
Uh-oh.
What?
Huh? Oh, this is 500, answer from category 3.
I think
Go back.
Something's wrong.
Well, now we know category three.
Shoot. Sorry about that one.
We'll just skip that one.
Skip that one, okay. Changes. What are the fighting scene below?
Oh, we got it.
You got it?
Yeah.
All right, good.
Well, I say we just do rapid now, because it's just going to be...
Go
ahead.
There are two pictures here. Okay, the top picture is Elshnik spot, because they spot, right? And then the bottom picture is linear configuration, so that's it, street.
Reverse.
Yeah, this reverse. Why do this happen? Yeah, so it's inhabitants of choreography, labral non-perfusion of the choroid capillaries. Early phase, they look more like tan color. Deep within the retina, and then as time go on, become pigmented and has a little bit of a halo hyperpigmentation around it. Okay, and the same pathology, but except in a more linear configuration along the choroidal arteries.
For the streaks, are they is it linear hyperpigmentation? Hypo.
Same pathology though.
I see.
Just linear configuration. Boris, what condition did this patient likely have?
I say no, because otherwise we're just going to be sitting there being like...
How about you guys just hit as soon as... I don't have to read. Just hit it.
Yeah.
I'm a slow reader.
Okay. Let's do... Why not? Let's do phacomatoses for 100.
Oh, yeah.
The picture tied off. 27-year-old man with this finding. His father was also affected by the same syndrome. What is the most likely cause of death in this syndrome? Most likely cause of death in this syndrome.
Yes, renal cell carcinoma.
Oh, that's right.
Yes.
Question.
I didn't read the question.
Question.
I was just asking, and I was like, why
do
you
have
renal cell? I don't care.
What is the name of the condition here?
We look at the eyes.
Okay. What are the organs affected by this condition?
Brain.
What else?
Kidney.
Okay, what else? Pancreas. Yeah. Oh, I should ask which chromosome? Autosomal dominant. Yeah. So you. Wait, I didn't put it in here for some reason. The location.
I just didn't know.
Oh, yeah, kidney, pancreas, liver cysts, and of course the brain and eye, right? CNS stuff. Okay.
Can you go back to the pictures of the question?
Yeah.
I'm just looking at like what's going on here.
Okay. So
what's an MRI?
You know, on FA, this is not as leaky here, but for active lesion like this, how would you treat this?
Laser the supply.
Yeah, hot laser, photocoagulation around this laser. However, you probably want to try, there's a vein here, right? So you're going to try not to laser the vein because then you would occlude and you lead to congestion. Moving on.
Let's keep going. Phacomatoses for
200.
A young patient has...
Sir,
daily
double.
...recent tooth extraction. You see this on retinal exam. What is the inherent...
Answer, daily double.
You answered the question.
Answer, daily double.
Yes.
Sporadic.
Sporadic.
Did we do a David...
Sporadic.
We
sporadic, so no real genetic inheritance pattern, Wyburn-Mason syndrome. You look like worms, right? Congenital retinal AVM with ipsilateral AVMs in face, orbit, mandible, that's why the bleeding teeth, bleeding with a dental appointment. Complication, retinal vein occlusion because of kinking and vitreous hemorrhage. Okay. Does not leak on FA.
Fiber and Maki.
Here you go, Tony.
Let's do diabetic retinopathy for 200.
Got it. In this patient with diabetic retinopathy, what is the cause of vision loss? What is shown here, guys? Okay, this is a patient with a normal FAZ. This patient has, this is a different image. So if you imagine enlarging that, this is some capillary dropout at the foveal area and also temporal to the macula as well. What is roughly an average FAZ? Yeah, it varies, but I would say around 350-ish. That's,
yeah.
350 is micrometer. And this has been shown to be just some correlation with the degree of retinopathy. So most prominent in PDR. And then on OCT, for macular ischemia, how would that present on OCT? Central loss of or attenuation of the ISOS layer. So thin right there, photoreceptor loss. That's pretty chronic, right? So enlarged FAZ. Yeah, so that's one of the three main causes of vision loss from diabetic retinopathy. The first one is macular edema, macular ischemia, which you can't really see on your exam, right? Because you can't really visualize that unless you get an OCT or an FA. So requires some imaging to make that diagnosis.
So you're saying the ischemia, that's what leads to the ISOS function, or
mm-hmm.
the IS.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, diabetic retinopathy for 300.
What stage of diabetic retinopathy is seen here? How will you treat this patient? Okay?
Severe NPDR.
Good job. So this is from one of the clinical trials. It's demonstrating IRMA, which stands for intraretinal microvascular abnormalities. So inherently, this had to be NPDR, right? Because the definition of PDR, proliferative disease, that it had to be extraretinal, so above the retinal surface. They shut vessel and look squiggly. So on exam sometime for me, it's difficult for me as well to distinguish between IRMA and NVE, or early NVE. So IRMA was NVE in those patients, I would get an FA, just so I would know for sure. And there are times where I felt so confident that this is PDR, that looked just like NVE, get an FA and it showed no leakage. For example, we had that one patient, Mike, at the VA that day. I thought the right eye has severe.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I didn't FA that day because he had to wait around anyway for his pressure to drop down. Yeah. In the end, we still give him prophylactic laser in the OR because of his history of like poor follow-up, and now his other eye has NVG.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Can you point out where the IRMA is in the spot?
Yes. Here.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is not.
Where?
You see right here.
It's like at the end of the little cap.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah. This is not a great photo. Sorry, guys.
I mean, that one.
Yeah.
That one is
one
that I see.
That one.
Yeah. But this area here.
That one. Wait, am I looking at blood vessels?
Even here, too.
Okay, I see the bottom one there.
Yeah, this one here, too. Here as well.
I think that's a really good description of it, is abnormal dilation of existing capillaries.
Yeah.
Versus, like, sometimes they look pretty frond-like, but...
Yeah. Yeah. Heart. So just get an FA. Yeah. Okay.
Coming back, you guys.
You guys are so
I think the black and white photo will show it more.
Yeah.
We're gonna finish the category for 400
diabetic
retinopathy.
I just love
this
show.
How
were
you
two? Daily double.
Answer, daily double.
Well, maybe they have.
Answer, daily double.
I love
Answer, daily double.
Perp.
Mandatory for high-risk PDR, right? So what is this here?
NVD.
Okay.
Greater than
all right, high-risk PDR, I don't like how like they describe here because, you know, this is so trivial. Just knowing you had an NVD with or without VTIM and any VTIM. Just two things to remember, because otherwise it's just going to like, try to, like, are you going to stare and measure? Is it 1/4 or 1/2? Yeah.
Well, and if it's less than 1/4, if you don't do anything, it's going to get greater, so.
And just know that even though, so then it would be high, it would be non-high-risk PDR, right? But just know that in that study, it is that it doesn't mean that you can't do the laser. You should still offer the patient. It's just that it's not as mandatory, yeah. Oh yeah, and then just touch base on the protocol as we talked about already, and there are risks and benefits to each of the two treatment modality, right? With anti-VEGF, endophthalmitis, tear, detachment, TRD, RRD, why? Because of, you know, contraction, if they have peripheral NVE that has already regressed, has membrane there, can contract rapidly because anti-VEGF work really fast, right? You see patient with florid NVI, you're doing anti-VEGF, then after they come back 24 hours, less than 24 hours, it's like, whoa, it's like almost gone. Okay, so that's why that rapid contraction, you see that. That's why when a patient was presented with peripheral TRD, but I also had blood, I don't do anti-VEGF. I would do as much laser as I could. Okay. Bonus question. The answer was already on the previous slide.
Yeah.
Had PRP. You see this, what is the diagnosis? Wait, any ringing the bell?
Yeah, we did.
What's the answer?
I said TRD.
Is it TRD?
But is it also like the choroidal effusions that can happen? Or can't you get like choroidals after?
What's your answer?
Pick one.
Or it could be endophthalmitis, or it could be.
Why would this be endophthalmitis?
I'm kidding. I'm teasing Catherine.
I think it's an effusion, choroidal effusion.
Yes, it's a choroid detachment.
Detachment.
Yeah. So just know that TRD, unless there is a retinotoxinous component,
yeah,
is usually, you know, kind of shallow, kind of flat. It's not gonna be bulgy like this. And also, you know, this it has to be choroidal because this is the laser spot.
Yeah. Yeah, go for it. Vascular occlusions for 200.
Tyler, you have your buzzer.
Oh, it does be so fast. What is the diagnosis of this? There you go. Retinal whitening. Yeah. Hey, on the OCT, in which layer is there edema? It's actually, yes, but specifically is the retinophyto layer. And how long would that take for it to not be visible on OCT?
Like for a month.
Huh? Yeah, around a month. Just kind of like how just kind of like how, you know, when you have optic nerve damage, right, it takes about 4 to 6 months for it to present as an atrophy on your OCT or NFL scan. So when patient, that's why the diagnosis of, okay, then after 3 months, what do you see on OCT in this area?
Thinning.
So the diagnosis of artery occlusion, very difficult to make on a clinical exam if you don't see it acutely. And then you rely on your OCT to know that they have this prior. So, and if you're on FA, if you canalize and then you don't really see the feeling defect anymore in the chronic phase. Okay. Hypoperfusion from emboli, found in 62% of the case, look for one. Sometimes you don't see them though. Temporal artery involved in most of the cases. You know what is actually the best way to see this emboli? Is the IR imaging that come along with the OCT macula. Okay, so you know there are different kind of emboli. They talk about Hollandhorst plaque, which is cholesterol. They also like platelet fibrin emboli, calcific emboli. You know, this thing is kind of obsolete these days because this is more relevant in the old day where there is, you know, poor access to systemic workup, you know, echocardiogram versus cardiac ultrasound where you have to kind of target and you look, okay, you look at this and which one, which test you want to get, right, to have the highest yield. Nowadays, a patient present with an emboli or CRAO, BRAO, acutely, you would send that to the ED for stroke workup and then she get all those tests anyway. So I wouldn't sit there and try to decide which kind of emboli this patient has. It's more for academic exercise than practical patient care.
Wow. Okay. Oh, bonus.
Right, this is a bonus again. Okay. 46-year-old female presented with headache that worsened and became confused, disoriented and off balance, tinnitus and vertigo also developed. Admitted to neurology for and noted to have vision changes. How do you treat her? How do you treat her?
IVIG.
Yeah. Steroids.
God damn it.
Yeah.
Okay.
What is the diagnosis?
Susac.
So high dose steroid early on. And the other thing that you mentioned, I'm sure they used to at some point, but the first thing is high dose steroid.
Neurology's favorite.
Oh yeah, they keep sending us patients.
They ask you.
For
they
FA.
They see it once and they're like, oh.
Yeah.
I had one last year that they were right about, and then ever since then they get consulted on it at least like twice a month. To
this girl through. Has headaches and she didn't hear me once when I came in the room. Consult for Susanics.
Triad of encephalopathy, because of brain infarct. BIO and hearing loss, treat with oral steroid, immunosuppression with the thing that Catherine mentioned. Okay. Oh yeah, and the other stuff. Okay.
A chance.
Let's
stay in that category.
That's right here. So vascular occlusions for 300.
Yeah, baby.
What does the occlusion typically occur in this condition? Ilya said that in her presentation.
Behind her.
What?
At or behind her.
Okay.
Herbivore.
Yeah, this is a better word. Let me the kibosa.
Sorry.
I mean the
herbivore
and play with
the
nose.
The crib.
Okay.
I don't think we should get that one.
In the crib.
I'm giving points to us.
NVIs occur in 60% of patients in ischemic CRVO within 3 to 5 months. Ischemic CRVO was defined as, you know, more than this diameter of ischemia on FA that was mentioned in Lydia's presentation. How come we don't see this as often clinically then? What do you guys think we don't see as common?
Oh, you mean NVI?
Mm-hmm. This is a really high prevalence, right? But how come clinically we don't see it as much?
Start them right away.
Yes, because we treat them not because of, you know, not to prevent NVI, but because they almost always in CLBO have central macular edema, right? So then you treat them with anti-VEGF and that just masks. That just masks the ischemic load.
Okay. Does it mask it or does it just decrease it?
No, I don't think so. What I meant by mask is that it masks the non-perfusion. So unless you get an FA, you won't know how much pathology that they really have. And then these patients lots of follow up, they come back after COVID and then they have a lot of complication. Yeah. Okay. So that's why, let's say, you know, for patients who are getting injection, you're not gonna do a goniotoscopy, right? To looking for NVI and VA. But let's say for patients who does, and there are rarely this happens, but there are some patients, maybe a handful of patients who don't have macular edema that requires treatment. So this patient, you have to be more diligent in doing maybe, at Northwestern, we actually do like, for the first month, NVI, goniotoscopy every month, and then every after that, every 6 months, we do the goniotoscopy, if they don't need treatment. But if they're already getting anti-VEGF frequently, then you don't have to be as diligent.
Vascular occlusions for
200.
Wait, did you take
that
bar?
Yes, I did.
60-year-old female with sudden loss of vision. What is the diagnosis? Got it?
Yeah. GCA.
Pam? Ciliary retinal artery occlusion.
Yeah. Like
spare. Wrong.
Or sparing.
Yeah, this is
big. What are you doing?
Well, she's 60 years old, right? Okay. Yeah.
So you're doing minus points?
This is a beautiful picture. Look at retinal whitening anywhere. Sparing. Sparing is dripping the macula that corresponds to the area of retained perfusion.
I said the wrong thing too, Catherine.
Yeah. And that is the RNFL infarctedema, right? On the OCT. This had to be acute. This had to be within the first 2 weeks. Yeah. And then this is the classic chair rest spot in central retinal artery occlusion that without a ciliary sparing, right? The previous one has some sparing. Yeah. Okay. Retinal ischemia. I call that RNFL edema, but it's just ischemia that's swelling up. Yeah.
See, bonus.
Yeah.
You remembered from Nico.
Do not miss.
I just mean like you shouldn't have 6-year-old.
That was a bonus one. I didn't miss. I don't.
I have a ciliary retinal artery.
Yeah. Okay. Do you have to? So in when they present like acutely, you do send them to the ED for ESR, CRP, and stroke workup. But if they present to you like
2 weeks later.
2 weeks later, just do routine outpatient. Yeah. Oh. Okay. I'll ask a question in the next slide. Let's go on.
Yeah, vascular occlusions for 400.
I think that we didn't do vascular occlusions for 200.
Oh, we haven't? Okay, let's do that one.
No.
I'm just letting you know. I'm just saying.
Name more risk factor for this condition. Yes.
Yay.
This is BRVO. Glaucoma is one of them. Age, hypertension, smoking, hypercoagulability, not diabetes, which is a risk factor for CRVO. In clinical practice, I still screen patients for diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This bonus question were mentioned in Lydia's presentation as well. Number one, where are the occlusion in BRVO typically occur? And number two, in which quadrant are BRVO most commonly located?
At the crossings of arterioles and veins.
There you go.
Yeah,
Talia, remember in the VA clinic the other day, the patient consulted retina for consultation for macular edema, and we needed ask for an FA staff left. But when you look at the IR imaging, you can clearly see the kinking of the the nicking of the arterial and vein, and that's it's like a telltale sign for restoring a vein occlusion, and you don't have to get an FA really to start treatment.
Why is it superior temporal? Do we know? It's just.
Yeah, actually, I don't know.
Gravity.
Gravity. Now, here's a question.
Okay. No, I think that's right. It's good.
For both, okay, patient present to you, and before you see the patient, you already see the image. You know, you look at the OCT, the color photo, and you know your diagnosis. What should you do next, right away? This is a cue. All
right. What was the question?
Check your blood pressure.
Yeah. Check the blood pressure, and I wouldn't necessarily even I wouldn't start treatment in the clinic. I would send the patient to the if their blood pressure is really high, I would send the patient to the ED and delay treatment because, you know, just the high just the, some association with like stroke, heart attack, and especially if they present to you with acute vein occlusion, high blood pressure, that is considered like a crisis. Just send them to the ED. Come back later for anti-VEGF. You don't want to cause a complication with your treatment. Okay. Which one of the medication has been in some of the old study most commonly associated with those systemic risk factor? Lucentis. Okay, moving on.
SCR occlusions 400.
FA on the last patient review this. How will you treat this patient? Okay, I think I missed some information here. Actually no, just keep it that way. By the way, there's no NVI, there's no vitreous hemorrhage. Yeah.
Observation.
Yeah. So this FA show a lot of ischemia, however, did not demonstrate NV. So according to the AAO recommendation, you don't treat ischemia in vein occlusion, you treat NV. NVI, NVE, NVD. Okay. PRP only, and the reason for that is when they did another study, when you do prophylactic PRP in this patient, 30% of them still get NV anyway, and also there's no difference in the outcome for patients who get prophylactic treatment and who did not. But make sure, kind of make you want to treat that, right? I think if this is a VA patient with or someone with his poor follow-up, I probably would just do some sectoral laser just to be on the safe side. Yeah. Okay.
There's so much.
Because they don't have vision there anyway.
Just blast.
It's just asking for it.
Xenon.
Vascular occlusions are 500. Nope, wrong one. There you go, Catherine. Team, right? Name hypercholic disorder associated with BRVO, CRVO.
All
of them. I just need a top five, it's fine. One. There's one more that you haven't mentioned that is
polycythemia.
Like blood dysgrachias.
Tyler wants it.
This one I was looking for. This one. Hypohomocysteinemia.
Oh, sure.
But everything that you mentioned, yes. I didn't include all of them here.
Yes.
So-called lupus is the autoimmune vasculitis stuff. But yes, factor V, Leiden, 5 Leiden, and anti-phospholipid syndrome, what is strong, all those check out.
Because it's not occluded.
Yeah.
I didn't hear what you said, sorry. There's some hypervisc in like PV and like Waldenstrom. Oh, okay, gotcha. I see. Okay, arterial occlusion disease for 400.
Oh.
Pam.
Right? You like Pam so much. 35-year-old with sick day, he's with acute vision loss. Vision 2040. What is the diagnosis? Pam. Yeah. So the hyperreflectivity instead of hyper.
Yeah.
Yeah. Instead of in the retinal fiber layer, as you see in auric occlusion, this is more of in the layer of the retina, but not in the RNFL. And then this actually is a pretty nice IR image that kind of visualize these changes down on the IR as hyporeflectivity. Your female with a history of hypertension come in with dark and nasal fusion in the right eye. OCT below show 2 months later. What is the diagnosis? Someone said that already. Pam, same stuff. So I do, in my mind, they are the same. Okay. It's just the variability in the different layers of where the lesion are, and it had to do with poor perfusion to either the deep capillaries layer versus the middle layer. It's the same spectrum of the same disease. Yeah. Most commonly associated with high blood pressure. Yeah. Persistent scotoma can get better, but a lot of time, most of the time in my experience, stay for a long time. A few months at least. I don't know if like a year or 2 years out they get better, but they tend to be persistent. And then you don't really see this on your clinical exam. It's very hard to see. So the IR and the OCT visualize that much better. Same thing, along the same thing here. Yeah, let's move on here. Yeah, that's AMN. Pam, AMN, same pathology. Yeah. It's ischemia, right? Of the capillary layer, capillaries. Or does it go up?
Bonus questions are $50 each.
Can this lesion
cause?
We already know this. Oh, yeah.
Ram.
I want a ram.
But how come you didn't hit the bell?
I did. We know it because it was the answer that
no,
was.
No, but
he's
fastest finger.
What is the answer? What is the answer? What kind of hemorrhage can this lesion cause?
Ram.
What kind of hemorrhage?
Hemorrhage.
In what layers?
Subretinal.
In all layers.
Any of them. Okay, we know.
Okay, so beside RAM, what other retinal disease can cause hemorrhage in all layer?
NAT.
Say that again?
NAT.
What?
NAT.
Oh, yes. Trauma. So.
Tursins.
Trauma. Good. And then more.
Diabetic retinopathy.
Not DR. Diabetic retinopathy is intraretinal.
AMD.
Yeah. And wet AMD, yes. So CNVM, that breakthrough. Mm-hmm. And most commonly seen in what? PCV. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's so. And then one more. Rarer. Melanoma. So Turgeon syndrome, RAM. CNVM classically in PCV. more common in CV, PCV than in AMD, but we do see in AMD, right? Melanoma and trauma, non-accidental abuse. Mm-hmm. So those are the few things that can cause bleeding in all layers of the retina. Yeah, okay. Yeah, he had multiple layers. Observe laser effluent threatening the macula. Okay. Where do these commonly occur? This lesion?
So where?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Just in terms of the anatomy. Within the first three order of bifurcation, arterial bifurcation.
Say that again.
Within first three order of arterial bifurcation.
Oh, okay.
So you don't have to look far out, right?
Yeah, it should be. Okay. Phacomatosis for 300.
How would you treat this lesion?
We're gonna laser the butt somehow.
Mm-mm. Hemangioma. No treatment indicated unless cause vitreous hemorrhage. Laser photocoagulation or cryo.
Ugh.
Yeah. Look like grapes.
It looked like there was hemorrhage.
The media was not.
Was there?
No.
No.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, just go for it.
Okay. Was that 400?
That was 300.
We'll do 400.
Ooh, what is the diagnosis? Good job. Go ahead. Yeah.
Color bus.
Tuberous sclerosis. What is the name of this lesion?
Astrocytoma.
Yeah. Astrocytoma. Okay, you guys can read that. Moving on. What is this finding and what syndrome can this be associated with? This is hard. Okay, cool. Let's see.
Wow!
Oh my gosh!
Wow.
Yeah. And F2. Block fluorescein with telangiectatic vessel.
Wow.
That's a good one. That's the hardest one, I think, of all the phacomatosis.
Good job.
Yeah.
Is it NF2?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. I know that that's like in my notes, but I don't know. I don't think I've ever really understood what it looked like.
Yeah. I haven't seen it.
It doesn't have pictures.
Does it have pictures of it?
Of most things.
Yes. I've never seen a picture of it. I mean, I must have. It's your last year. But.
Shall we move on? I think Sokol team, right? Got that?
All right.
Okay, 45-year-old female who received external beam radiation for a nasal pharyngeal tumor. What is the diagnosis?
Oh.
Yes.
Oh, boy.
So, in radiation retinopathy, more often than not, you see more convoluted spot versus hemorrhage.
I'm pretty sure it's Mubarak's
pick. Convoluted spot. Oh, shoot. There you go, just fine. Name at least one cause for this fighting.
Hepatitis.
Yeah.
Infections.
Bone fragment.
Fat embolism, acute pancreatitis, childbirth because of like embolus from the amniotic fluid, and vasculitis disease.
I did?
Yeah, we showed you the picture and you're like, that looks like purchase. And we're like, oh
okay.
My
God. Bonus question here.
It's our
fiber layer and then purchase like in is deeper, but I don't know what layer.
I think it's opioid.
Retinal capillary bed.
Oh, seriously.
Yeah. I think we missed this. We did this one already.
We
Yeah, the 500 one.
I don't think so.
What was it?
Go against glow.
Oh, shoot, no.
Okay.
All right.
Oh, it's easy one.
This is the
56-year-old woman with recent trauma
terse.
And subarachnoid hemorrhage presenting with blurry vision. What is the diagnosis?
Double jeopardy.
Terse.
Oh, shish.
Yeah, you got it.
Give us our points.
Yeah. So here you see that. You can see there's blood underneath subretinal because you can see the vessel above it, right? This is subretinal. This is dark blood. This is more like intraretinal here. And this had to be sub-ILM because, you know, kind of that bulk shape. So ILM is still kind of like preventing it from coming. And this is actually, I think these are also still sub-ILM. It hasn't got into the vitreous yet. Yeah, that's why you have a nice clear view. Sub-ILM, yeah.
You want a score update before final?
Yes. What's the treatment?
Watch.
Thugs and drugs.
Oh, for this patient. And the
say thugs and drugs.
Hugs and
drugs. Talk
to me.
Observation.
Observe if it's not affecting the vision, but you know, if it's vitreous hemorrhage not clearing or that I don't see how it's gonna like burst on its own. Unless the patient develop a PVD. But even with the PVD, the IOM is gonna stay behind. So then we have a case, it's not from Turgeon, but the patient has sub-ILM hemorrhage from probably a combination of Valsalva and diabetic actually for her, because she was pregnant. And Dr. Valkenburg yak this.
Was it in the macula?
It was in the macula.
Holy.
Yeah.
Let the dam go, huh?
he tried to burst, break through that ILM to let blood escape, and hopefully that would resolve. But the thing is, like, it just give her, you know, a giant vitreous hemorrhage that doesn't clear, and then later on develop RT.
Yeah.
Okay, anyway, don't yak it.
You're like, we'll just not uproot this one.
Too risky, I think. Yeah.
It's too much of me like yelling.
I think we did this one, yeah. That, because I accidentally clicked it. Okay, go back.
Is there a final Jeopardy?
Yes, so, you know, my final Jeopardy question is really lame.
That's okay.
Okay. Shall we just do it? Let's do it.
Maybe score update.
Yeah, okay. So, if a team buzzed in and answered correctly, including the
this is very nitpicky.
Just a sec. We're not ready. We have to wager.
Yeah, so our team is 2,500. Your team is 2,100.
We're team Percher Flex.
Did you give us our 1,000 for that last one?
No.
It was Double Jeopardy for 500.
Everything's Double Jeopardy.
We haven't been doing Double Jeopardy.
Yeah, there was more other Double Jeopardy.
I don't think everything was Double Jeopardy.
No, there was a whole bunch of stuff,
though. There was other ones.
Where were
you? Oh, yeah.
We want to recount.
Stop
the steal.
Okay.
Oh, what is it?
This is a hard one because I know
Maricopa County.
Yeah. It's not super hard. We should know this, but I noticed that a lot of us don't pay attention to this.
Oh no.
Ready?
No.
Wait, so
we have to wager first.
We're not buzzing, you just answer, right?
Yeah, you just answer afterwards.
You answer, you like write down.
Which eye is this?
What?
Write down what you're wagering.
Well, it's a secret.
I know, we'll write it down. I don't trust you guys.
Alright. You guys did the scoring. I mean, we don't trust you
guys.
I
watched you do. Yeah, I was like, every time we answer something incorrectly, I was like, we're starting out with a negative 500. Yeah, we started with a negative 500.
Leave us alone. Do we have to write it down? Can we just, like, establish
I'll type it right here. It's fine.
Liars.
Again, our wager.
Where are you writing it down?
On the spreadsheet.
It's right here.
Okay, so if you're typing, then we're typing. Miranda's not competitive at all for anyone looking at these. It's a nurturing environment.
Okay.
This would be really hard.
Sure.
Yeah, I know, right?
Oh, gosh.
Ready?
Okay. We're ready.
Right.
Okay. So are we writing this down? Or?
No, wait.
So last year, Nico's question was, like, which country has a national hero, right?
Yeah.
So mine is still, like, relevant to this entire lecture. So it's not as fun.
Oh, I want it to be random.
But I was having a hard time thinking about one such and such type of
one.
Philippines.
Answer, Daily Double.
Oh, yes!
Answer, Answer, daily double.
Very nitpicky, especially I know that the VA is going to be the scientist.
That's right.
Answer, daily double.
Are you guys
answer, daily double. 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 Answer, daily double.
I know.
Answer, daily double.
Some of our teammates don't even pay attention to this, and we have to double check every now and then.
Answer, daily double. Answer, daily double. Answer, daily double. Answer, daily double. Answer, daily double.
We're not cheating.
Answer, daily double. 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 Answer, daily double.
Okay, we don't know, but we'll see.
Answer, daily double.
All right.
Answer, daily double.
Go ahead. Three indication.
Answer, daily double.
You put Andy, BRVO, CRVO.
Andy?
BRVO, CRVO.
BRVO, CRVO.
Answer, daily double.
That's two.
And those were our two and three that we wrote down.
Okay.
Answer, daily double.
Put DME.
Okay, so you're missing one. So I'll give you.
Answer, daily double.
You got the other four. Okay, just.
So for.
Answer, daily double.
PR, DME, wet AMD, and then for 0.3.
Answer, daily double.
So I think this team got it. Yeah.
Answer, daily double.
The most important thing here is, what is 0.3 used for, right? And it's for diabetic macular edema. And so 0.5 is indicated for wet AMD, CMA signature vein occlusion, and myopic CNVM.
Didn't Bravo and Crew show that 0.3 was not significantly different than 0.5?
That's why we do 0.3. So for insurance purpose, we do 0.3.
Say what?
But that was
insurance purpose because that's what is proven and indicated for.
Yeah, protocol I did 0.5 for DMD.
All of our studies did 0.5.
Was there a newer study?
There is another study that said no difference between 0.3 and 0.5, and that's how we come to the conclusion of using 0.3 is just as good and it's cheaper.
So why didn't they do that for Bravo?
Yeah, I saw that you guys did that too, and I have to look back on why they chose that. But the bottom line is, in clinical practice, 0.3 for diabetic macular edema, 0.5 for everything else.
Yeah. Also, our protocol S.
Yeah.
They did
0.5. Yeah.
For PDR.
That's why it's tricky.
Wait, but it's not up there.
That was.
I said for.
I think the hogam is right.
No, but I mean protocol S, they did 0.5 Lucentis for PDR.
So actually, you're right. But the indication as listed by the company is still for, it's still 0.3. It's still 0.3 for diabetic retinopathy with DME.
Okay.
But knee vascularization.
Yeah, with
the knee.
It's still 0.3 for any kind of diabetic stuff. It's still 0.3.
In our study for protocol S, they use 0.5, but the asterisk that we deleted off our slide was that 0.3 wasn't FDA approved yet. So I guess later it was FDA approved. Yeah. But that's what we based our.
I've never paid attention. Does that actually happen here?
Yes. So like when we do the prior authorization, right? You have to put in a diagnosis, right? And you have to put in diabetic macular edema or blah blah blah. But that's why it's tricky. So you guys don't do this at the VA.
Is it a cost thing where we don't get Lucentis to the VA, or just like a contract?
It's a cost and contract. So let's say in a lot of study, right?
Yeah.
You Avastin, Lucentis, and Alia, right? And you may see a benefit with Alia for patients with worse vision, like 20/50, right? You can let's just do Alia for this patient. But the cost between Avastin and Alia is like $50 versus $1,000-something. But the cost difference between Lucentis and Alia is like $800 versus $1,000.
Right, which is why I wonder why we don't have Eylea and Lucentis.
But that's the reason why we have Alia and not Lucentis, because the benefit of Alia and the cost difference is much, much more versus like, but we still do Avastin because it costs so much lower.
Right. I guess I don't know why we don't have Avastin and Lucentis instead of Avastin and Eylea or whatever.
That must have to do with the contract. But if we were to choose medication for patient based on cost alone, right? If you are gonna make a big jump in cost, you might as well go for Eylea, because at least the one that is proven to be better for the outcome for patient with worse vision.
Yes.
Right. Right. Not Lucentis, right? So if you're gonna make a big jump, a couple hundred dollar, you're gonna make that jump for Eylea and not for Lucentis. Yeah. But I think the answer to your question has probably more to do with just the contract.
Cool.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. More importantly, how much did you wager?
Oh, we wagered $2,301.
$1.
No.
Yeah, so we win.
So you win.
You don't win.
What?
You didn't get it.
What?
You got it wrong.
So you got it wrong.
Yeah, I know.
Right.
Oh, well, you guys got it right. I guess we're counting
that you guys
got it more right.
Okay,
yeah,
this team
had more
right. Yeah.
So you win. Sorry.
I thought that was a joke, and then I realized you're serious.
We want the pudding stuff. What kind of pudding is it?
It's all mango flavor. Because I think mango flavor is the best. But there are 12 of them here, so I'm sure there's enough.
Yay.
Only if they want to share. It's their prize.
We do.